speaker for today is the Asia editor of EIR. It's Mike Billington. This is a book by Mike which tells about the vacation he took, all expenses paid by him and the federal government, Reflections of an American Political Prisoner, during which time he did much of the work you're about to hear. Mike.
Thank you. Thank you, Dennis. Sabbatical leave, I call it, not vacation. I'll try to, in the few minutes that we have left, answer some of the questions for which this conference was originally called and which came up in the discussion between Helga and Patrick Ho, which is the misconceptions about Western thought in China and misconceptions about Confucianism in the West. And in particular, something that I did, in fact, do a great deal of study on while I was on my sabbatical leave, which is precisely that it was the British who, when they semi-colonized China, set about, as they do in all of their colonies, to profile the philosophies and cultures of these nations and pick out those backward-tending tendencies in those cultures, like the caste system in India, and define that as the nature of the colony in order to keep them backwards and to maintain colonial power over a divided and backward nation. And this is what happened in spades in China, and it's still very, very much alive today, as we saw reflected in the brilliant presentation, but one which has this serious flaw of not recognizing the fact that this has that this is a misconception that persists today, is that this British liberalism, imperial mentality of Darwinism and survival of the fittest is somehow Western thought. And I want to go through that as quickly as I can. I think the main thing to start with is that both in the West and in China, there are not just these wonderful traditions which Helga so beautifully drew on today and which he drew on with, I think, some problems, but that these wonderful traditions that gave rise to these powerful civilizations were always battling with backward tendencies. And that wasn't discussed that much. You can understand why, but I think it's very, very important to see that because that's the way the empire works to subvert, as they are now subverting the United States. And if you, for instance, wonder how Americans could be so gullible as to believe that Russia and China are aggressive nations, that Russia is aggressive in the Ukraine and in Syria, that China is aggressive in the South China Sea, how could you believe such foolishness? Well, it's because they've profiled America in exactly the same way, which is what we're dealing with now. Now, in the case of Plato, and Plato and Confucius were roughly contemporaries, and they're very, very similar in their recognition that it's the human mind and the capacity to be creative and to love mankind, which characterizes man. But in the case of Plato, there was his opposite, Aristotle, who believed that man was an animal, that people were born either masters or slaves, that their mind was no better than a calculating machine, not a creative capacity to master laws of the universe and discover new principles, but rather just a calculating machine in an Aristotelian logic. And it was this Aristotelian ideology which always guides empire, as opposed to the Platonic, which gave rise to Renaissance thinking. And then the same thing in China. You had Confucianism, and Helga was absolutely right, I think, to call Patrick Ho on the issue of Taoism. Confucius believed in the Tao, in the way, in the principle of the universe, but Taoism, as it was developed by Lao Tzu and Chuang Tzu, was a policy which rejected creativity, which called for people to reject new technologies, but to live with nature, to commune with nature, rather than to change nature, which is the nature of creativity. And that Taoist influence was coupled with an even more evil influence called legalism, which was basically saying that man is an animal and can only be controlled through extremely strict government, strict laws, strict punishment, that you had to restrain the animal instincts of men through force of arms. And this was the ideology which guided the so-called First Empire in China and was a recurring problem through the Han Dynasty and the Tang Dynasty. And there was a renaissance in China in the Song Dynasty in the 12th century under Zhu Xi. And Zhu Xi was one of the great minds of China who, like Kuza, and like Leibniz, basically gave a rebirth to the original concepts of Confucianism. So these battles have gone on and on and on, and I'll say a few more things on that. The empire in the West, how does this thing work? I'm not sure how it works. Oh, there you go, okay. Yeah, okay. The empire in the West, and I think I have to say this for something that comes later, it's been a single empire from the Roman Empire through the Venetian Empire and then into the Anglo-Dutch Empire. It moved its headquarters, but it was always the same empire based on the Aristotelian or bestial idea of man. When the Jesuits first came, the Jesuits, Matteo Ricci, whom Patrick talked about, when he and his associates first came to China, their immediate response was to see the Buddhists in their saffron robes and to assume they were the religious leaders in China, and immediately identified with them and began collaborating with them. And they maintained collaboration with them over time, but they quickly learned that the real religious, the real philosophers of China were the Confucian scholars, who did not wear religious robes, but this was extremely important because in China at that time, the political leaders were the Confucian scholars. The way you became a political leader through the merit system that Professor Wang was talking about was that you passed examinations which were not examinations in calculations, but they were examinations in culture, in understanding Confucius and Mencius and so forth, and in poetry. You had to be a poet. You had to be a musician. You had to prove that you were truly a cultured person and therefore had the basis upon which you could be a moral ruler. So they quickly then established relations with the Confucians. This, as Patrick also indicated, I'll come back to that. This then led to Leibniz, who was discussed today, who, in correspondence with the Jesuits, was reading the translations of Confucius and Mencius, and especially of Zhu Xi in the Song Dynasty, and who recognized in China that, in Leibniz's mind, the fact that China had bigger cities by far than anything in Europe, more highly educated population than anyone in Europe, a better organized society, to him, this proved that Chinese philosophy, which he hadn't yet mastered, but he knew that Chinese philosophy had, in fact, mastered the fundamental laws of man and nature. That only knowing the truth about the laws of the universe can lead to a successful culture over the long term. This is the way Leibniz viewed this. He published Novissima Sinica, News from China, based on the writings that he had, mostly of Zhu Xi, actually, but also the Confucius and Mencius. And it was conveying the truth about China to the Europeans at that time. What Leibniz had to say about Confucianism was, quote, "It is pure Christianity insofar as it renews the natural law inscribed in our heart, i.e. every human being is born with this potential for truth in his heart and mind." And this is the Platonic idea of man, all men, being capable of creative developments and moral society. This Wis Kong Shi, who was mentioned, the king, the emperor at that time, who got to know the Jesuits extremely well. He mastered the Christian ideology. He didn't become a Christian. He didn't think he needed to, as Patrick Ho was pointing out. But he believed that these truths about man and nature cohered with Confucianism, and he invited the Jesuits to go throughout the country to spread their religion. There was no problem with this whatsoever. I would definitely squabble with with Patrick's description of how that fell apart. He said the Catholic Church decided that the Confucian rites contradicted Christian ideas and Christian rites, and therefore they broke off the connection. It didn't work that way. The empire intervened. Venice intervened. It was the Venetians who went to work on the Vatican to stop the popes who were collaborating with the Jesuits and to basically coerce them, just like Trump was coerced, you know, to go against the Christian self-interests and declared that since Confucians honored their ancestors, this did not cohere with Christian thought. Therefore, you could not be both a Christian and a Confucian. But keep in mind, the Confucians were the government leaders. So to say that Christianity was against Confucianism was to say it was against the state. And that's why Kangxi had to basically say, I can't believe this. I mean, this is absurd, but I have to throw you out. And finally did. And that laid the basis for just a couple hundred years later for the British to come in with their gunboats and their opium. And this was a cartoon of the time, but it's exactly true. That's how they conquered the country. They blew up their cities and they forced them to take opium. They fought the war because the Chinese were trying to stop them from bringing opium in. So this was the beginning of the horror of the British role in China. Now, here's where what I wanted to go through begins. Immediately the British picked up a bright young scholar named Yen Fu, who was an opium addict, which they considered very important, that he had was more imaginative because he was an opium addict, sent him off to London, and Yen Fu was trained in depth by the British in Darwin, in the survival of the fittest, in especially in Herbert Spencer, who was the person who brought Darwinism to social Darwinism, that man, in fact, is just an animal, that it's not through the creativity of the mind that man progresses, but by the strong defeating the weak, survival of the fittest. He learned these ideas, took them back to China, basically wrote the curriculum for all the schools that were under British direction, and taught that the British conquered us because they had wealth and power. Where did they get wealth and power? They got wealth and power by this Darwinian idea of crushing the weak, being willing to crush the weak in order to be strong. We have to learn how to be Darwinian and be strong and crush the weak. This was the total brainwashing, attempt at brainwashing the Chinese population. So I would just, in passing, point out that this is exactly the way Barack Obama was brainwashed into being a killer. His stepfather in Indonesia, as he writes about in his book, he suspected his father had been part of the slaughter of the PKI, of the Communist Party in Indonesia under Sukarno. And he asked him, have you ever seen a man killed? And his father said, yes, indeed, I have. He didn't admit he killed people, which he had. But he said, yes, indeed. And the reason you must learn, my son, my stepson, that there are two kinds of people. There's the strong and there's the weak. And the strong have to be willing to crush the weak. What are you going to be? Are you going to be strong or are you going to be weak? And Obama writes about that in his book, which is where his killer instincts came from. Here's what Yen Fu said, and I'll read this. There may be those who say that according to Adam Smith, The Wealth of Nations, book, and here he's talking about Smith's theory of moral values, but he says, there are those who say that according to Smith's book, human morality is nothing more than a matter of self-interest and the pursuit of profit, and the principle of heaven will be lost. He's obviously referring to the American system advocates who would argue that such a thinking, you'd lose the principle of heaven. What they do not understand, Yen Fu said, is that science concerns itself with questions of truth and falsehood and not with whether its findings coincide with benevolence and righteousness. There's no morality in science. It's just observation. It's not creative thinking. It's just observation, sense perception. Now, just to confirm that what he's saying, here's what Adam Smith actually says in the theory of moral sentiments. Nature has directed us to achieve happiness by original and immediate instincts. Hunger, thirst, the passion which unites the two sexes, the love of pleasure and the dread of pain, prompt us to apply those means for their own sake and without any consideration of their tendency to those beneficent ends which the great dictator of nature intended to produce by them. All right? Is there any mention of the human mind in there? Pure instinct. Men are animals, no more, no less. And that is the conception which Yen Fu is defending against anybody with brains, and which he taught back to the Chinese to try to get them to believe it. Now, Patrick already went through this, the brilliance of Sun Yat-sen and his use of Lincoln's of the people, by the people, and for the people. Let me add that when he learned this when he was in Hawaii, being trained by a family, the Damon family, that came from Philadelphia and was part of the school of Henry Carey, that Helga's mentioned several times, the people who promoted the Hamiltonian school. And not only did he follow Lincoln, but his writings, his book, The Three Principles of the People, he explicitly talked about Alexander Hamilton, as well as John Quincy Adams and Lincoln. But he also understood the American system so well that he polemicized against Thomas Jefferson. He said that Hamilton understood the need for industry, for infrastructure, and for the education of all people, whereas Jefferson was an agrarianist, what's the word you would use there? Agrarian fanatic who believed in slavery and wanted to keep the country backwards as an agricultural nation. So he wrote about this. He taught the Chinese people this. This was Sun Yat-sen bringing the American system to China. So you can imagine that... one more thing on Sun Yat-sen. He recognized, this was coming about during the so-called May 4th movement, which Patrick also mentioned. During the war, the First World War, Sun Yat-sen polemicized against joining the British in the war against the Germans. He said, if we join the British and they win the war, which they probably will, don't think that we would share in the spoils. No. He said, we will be treated the way a farmer treats the silkworm. They will draw out the useful silk, and then the worm will be used as fish food. He said, we will be used as fish food, which is exactly what happened. They joined the British. The war ended. That's when Deng Xiaoping and Zhou Enlai went to France, that some of you know we've been talking about with our candidate in France. But after the war, the Chinese, having joined the British, were torn apart, divided up in pieces given to each of the imperial powers. So during that May 4th movement, which Sun was intervening in to build into a Republican movement, he polemicized against what he saw as the influence of a British irrationalism. He said, a group intoxicated with a new culture have begun to reject the old morality, saying that the former makes the latter unnecessary. They say there are no princes in a democracy, so loyalty is not needed and can be cast away. He identified this ideology with John Stuart Mill, another of the British ideologues, and he said this would make the 400 million Chinese like a sheet of loose sand, basically manipulable and not unified. So this is... Wait a minute. Oh, here, I went by this. This is his map in 1919. He did the international development of China. And you saw these maps yesterday by Professor Ni Lei of China's rail developments today. I mean, there it is. You know, this is what Sun Yat-sen laid out as the rail and water development of China in 1919 as an international project. So, in fact, what Xi Jinping and the Chinese are doing today is literally realizing that movement. So... The Chinese, the British recognized the extreme danger of Sun Yat-sen's American system intervention into China and had to crush it. So they sent their top agents, Bertrand Russell, whom Lyndon LaRouche has declared as the most evil man of the 20th century, was sent in. He was sponsored by the Anti-Religious Society. He argued that Christianity was the bane of the West and Confucianism was the cause of backwardness in China. He wrote a book called The Problem of China, which is entirely a noble savage piece saying that we should leave them happy in the mud, basically Taoists, happy as farmers with no science, no technology. This is his quote, "Chinese officials are, as a rule, corrupt and indolent, so that control by foreigners is necessary in creating a modern bureaucracy and to prepare the way for the creation of an efficient Chinese system. Instinctive happiness or joy of life is one of the most important goods we have lost through industrialization, as its commonness in China is a strong reason for thinking well of Chinese civilization. Progress and efficiency, for example, make no appeal to the Chinese, except to those who have come under Western influence. By valuing progress and efficiency, we have secured power and wealth. By ignoring them, the Chinese, until we brought disturbance, secured on the whole a peaceable existence and a life full of enjoyment. The noble savage. Keep the people backwards, and we can continue our control." Russell was a libertine and a homosexual. He most despised in Confucianism the honoring of the family. He said that the family was the honoring the family was holding the country back. He said that in China, the Malthus theory of overpopulation finds full scope. There's too many people. One thing Dr. Wang didn't get to, but is in his writings, is that Benjamin Franklin aspired to have America be as populous as China. That's what he wanted. And John Dewey, I won't go through it now. He came from the U.S., but he was working for J.P. Morgan, who was running the British takeover of the American banking system. He was the de-schooler. He said, you should learn by doing. You shouldn't learn by textbooks. You should all go out and dig in the dirt. I bring this up because Russell and Dewey, the words Russell and Dewey are very, very well known in China. People know that these were the people who brought Western thinking to China during the May 4th movement. And really what happened was that 45 years later, their ideas were implemented in China in the Cultural Revolution. The schools were shut down. People were sent out to work with the farmers. Scientists were attacked and killed. It was a nightmare for China. And it was these ideas, these British ideas, which gave birth to, with a lot more to say about that, but basically gave birth to what became that nightmare. So one last thing is this fellow, Joseph Needham. I'm sure none of you, except the Chinese here, have heard of Joseph Needham. The Chinese know him very well. He was one of the great British lovers of China. He loved China. He wrote 17 volumes of Science and Civilization in China. He's praised as somebody who respected the fact that the Chinese had developed great scientific ideas. And some of what he documents is true. But what's his purpose? His purpose was to show that all the great scientific developments in China... Let me stop. He had something called the Needham Question, which was amongst all China scholars for a long, long time, which is why did the development of China stop when the Renaissance took place in the West? What made it stop? Was his answer the Venetian Empire empiricists who shut down the collaboration? Was it the British Opium Wars? No, it was Confucianism. That's what stopped China's progress. And to explain how they had great science, he said, it was mysticism that gave rise to science. Magic gives rise to science, not Confucianism. Here's Joseph Needham's quote. "Rationalism proved itself less favorable than mysticism to the progress of science. Science and magic are in their early stages indistinguishable." And I'm kidding. "Rational theology was anti-scientific. Mystical theology proved to be pro-scientific. Thus, the interest taken in the early Royal Society in London in what we now can see were magical claims." Indeed, you probably know that when Newton's case was opened up after having, they'd refused to allow anybody to open his trunk, when they opened it, it turned out that Newton was a raving mystical fanatic, a magic believer in magic, which explains why Leibniz was able to basically show he was a fraud as a scientist. So he also had to explain somehow how the great period of scientific development in China came during that Song Dynasty Renaissance, which was a Confucian Renaissance under Zhu Xi. Well, it was pretty simple for Needham. He basically said Zhu Xi called himself a Confucian, but he was really a Taoist. And Leibniz, who loved Zhu Xi, Leibniz, he's a Taoist too. He doesn't really, and I won't go into the details, we don't have time, but it's a fascinating story. I think I can close with that. We now have this Confucian Renaissance, the Confucian Institutes around the world. I think there's a problem still in China. Joseph Needham is still thought of as a great hero to the Chinese. Oh, by the way, I meant to mention Joseph Needham. During the Cultural Revolution, he went to China and he wrote and spoke all over the world saying, this is the greatest revolution in Chinese history. Right? Going back to the Stone Age. And there's more to say about Needham. But, you know, the traditions of Russell and Dewey, the traditions of Yen Fu, the traditions of Needham are still very strong in China. This is what Xi Jinping is working against. This is what he had to root out and still has to root out. These are fundamental issues which are being fought out there. Luckily in China, you know, the humanists are winning. We have to link with that tradition in China, just as we have to link with our best traditions in the West in order to really realize this kind of a renaissance which we have to bring about. And to do that, the evil of the British system indeed must be crushed. We have to. We won't survive if we don't. So we need to know the tremendously inspiring presentation that Helga gave this morning. This is the basis on which we can move ourselves to the mission that we do have as a human race, but we have to recognize that we have to crush this British system if we're going to make it work. Okay, thanks.